We now had back-to-back platinum albums. People were starting to trust us again. We filled and even sold out venues again, bringing in 10,000 people, which, if not quite up to the old days, certainly put us in very credible company. The needle was moving in the right direction. Most importantly, I was making money doing what I loved, playing guitar, jumping around on stage and screaming and preening a lot. And yet, despite selling 2 million copies each of Lick It Up and Animalize, we certainly weren't top dogs anymore. Some bands, Van Halen, Def Leppard, and soon Bon Jovi, were selling 10 million copies of their albums. Despite the fact that we were making money, our record label could not have cared less about Kiss. I think the label was dominated by kids barely out of college who were busy going after bands like Dan Reed Network. And no wonder. 30 years later, they're still a household name, right? When we played concerts in New York, nobody from our own record company would bother to come. They would all be in some downtown club watching a band fresh out of a fraternity house basement. Nothing against Dan Reed or his network, but it was annoying and even hurtful to be taken for granted like that. The non-makeup albums became successful because the fan base gave us a second chance. The record company did fuck all for us. As we set to work on a follow-up album, Asylum, the problem for me was that my ostensible partner had the same attitude as the record company. Gene just didn't care. He would show up in the studio after being up all night with some third-rate band he was producing, exhausted, with some half-assed song he wanted to put on our album that he may or may not have actually written. Again, he felt he should get a quota of songs on the record, and again, he wasn't delivering the goods. He didn't devote the time to it. If I suggested he was spreading himself too thin, he said, no, I'm giving 100%. My feeling that there was a traitor in the midst grew daily every time Gene denied his subpar and often non-existent contributions to the band. Somebody wasn't playing for the team. Somebody was thinking only about himself. Kiss was a distant second on his agenda. You are the one person I thought I could always count on. When I voiced my sense of betrayal, Gene said, "Well, you can go do things too." That was evasive bullshit. If I did, there wouldn't have been a band or any albums. I wasn't about to see the band disintegrate, and he knew it. Not only that, the license he offered me to go do things was predicated on his own decision to do things. I wasn't looking for an excuse to do other things. He was. It wasn't like he conferred with me about what or when he was going to do things. He was just looking out for number one, with little regard for me. He also developed a new habit of using the Kiss logo and his Kiss makeup for personal projects without my approval, knowing full well it was needed. When I raised objections, he would offer a weak, insincere, sorry, only to be repeated again next time, as though we'd never spoken about it. He was clearly going to do whatever he wanted to, regardless of any objections from me or even his legal obligations under our partnership. For Gene, sorry was a meaningless hall pass to placate me, until he would, of course, do the same thing again when he thought it would benefit him. In actuality, it never meant sorry for what I did, it was purely sorry that it bothers you. In addition to being offensive and insulting, his total disregard hurt my feelings. Apparently, I just had to play by his rules. I had the choice of walking away or doing the work of two people. The catch was that I had to share the credit, even if I did double the work. The animosity continued to build. I also started to see more and more interviews where Gene took credit for things he was only partially responsible for, or in some cases had nothing to do with at all. And he never refuted or corrected misinformed or inaccurate assumptions from interviewers about his outsized role. When I would call Gene on it and show him quotes from countless interviews, he would emphatically tell me, "I didn't say that." Now, I wasn't new to doing Q&A features or taking part in a taped interview that was going to be transcribed and published later. The number of times I read something attributed to me that was untrue could have been counted on one hand with fingers to spare. If James Brown was the hardest working man in show business, then Gene Simmons was, at least according to his account, the most misquoted man in show business. I didn't buy it. Being lied to and having my role and the role of others diminished and even negated was not only selfish, it was unkind, it hurt. One thing Gene and I had always agreed on was that we were each other's brother. What we obviously did not agree on was how you treat your brother. One of the results of Gene's diminished involvement was that, at least in the context of the band, I shared the spotlight less. It became my spotlight. It wasn't by chance that my songs became the popular songs. Nobody else was putting in the time to write decent songs. If Gene wanted to be more than the bass player, he had to do something more. Anybody can write a song in 5 minutes. The difference is that since we had a record deal, Gene got to put his songs on an album, whether or not they were any good. When I wrote songs like Heaven's on Fire or Tears Are Falling, it was because I had to. I was the one doing the work, and I enjoyed getting the credit I deserved. During the height of MTV's popularity, I became a sort of 80s pretty boy, though it was certainly a different time, and with feathered earrings, rouge, and pink gloves, courtesy of Van Halen's stylist whom we hired, I looked as much like a drag queen as anything else. Let's just say the criteria for what was considered attractive was a little different during the hair band era. I had a few girlfriends during those years, but for the most part, relationships were still just about companionship and sex. I didn't want exclusivity and didn't expect it from women. I just wanted to have a good time. I had things sorted out so that even when we were off the road, I was never alone. I split my time between New York and LA, renting apartments out there or living at hotels like the Sunset Marquee. LA was the place I went to indulge in what always started as carefree excess with women. When those relationships inevitably got too complicated, I would go back to New York. Despite the newfound attention through Kiss music videos, I wasn't comfortable being a public figure all the time. With his movie career in mind, Gene sought to surround himself with the most famous people possible. I came in a distant second in that department. It was fun to read about who I was involved with in the gossip magazines, but it wasn't so much fun to read about a breakup. Once I peered over the shoulder of a woman who was reading an article in The Star in which the actress Lisa Hartman explained why she would never marry singer Paul Stanley. I could have done without that stuff. As far as my sexual exploits, during the 70s I had paddled around the pool, so to speak. During the 80s, I was doing backflips in it. I went to a party one night at the Playboy Mansion, and as soon as I walked in the door, I found myself standing in front of a Playmate of the Year whom I had seen in the magazine and thought was incredibly hot. We spoke for a few minutes and then she said, "Do you want to leave?" "Sure," I said, half wondering what would happen if she were to reply, "Then why don't you get the fuck out of here?" Instead she said, "Let's go." We continued the festivities at her place.
As far as I'm concerned, If everyone had more sex, there would be less violence. Shannon was the girl of my dreams. She kept getting more and more beautiful. She never asked me where I was going. She never asked me when I was coming back. When we were away from each other, I would call her every day without fail. Not because I had to, or because it was expected. That would never have worked for me. I did it because I wanted to. The year 1985 saw us solidify KISS, with the lineup consisting of Bruce Kulick, Eric Carr, Paul, and myself. We had another platinum seller with Asylum, and we were doing it all without makeup and without the original lineup. We'd had new business management who had taken over Bill O'Coin's duties from 82 on, and that relationship had run its course as well. We let them go and hired Larry Mazur as a consultant. We were hesitant to employ new managers. They wanted too much money. So for all intents and purposes, we were self-managed. At this time, Runaway came out, to generally favorable reviews. And I immediately got another movie offer. Wanted Dead or Alive was to be directed by Gary Sherman and would star Rutger Hauer. I was slated to play the villain. When I arrived on the set the first day of shooting, I was introduced to the crew and to Rutger. He came over, shook my hand, and right there in front of everyone took my face in his hands and kissed me full on the mouth. The crew laughed their heads off. I was stunned. I enjoyed working on the movie, but my film career was really starting to irritate Paul and management. They wondered if I wanted to stay in the band or go for an acting career. The answer was that I wanted it all, but that wasn't entirely fair to Paul, who was committed to KISS full-time. I acted in another movie called Never Too Young to Die. This time I played two roles, one as a CIA agent, and the other as his alter ego, a transvestite rock star named Ragnar. I wore stiletto heels and a bra with a corset attached. I wore women's makeup. I wore fishnet stockings. I looked like an evil painted woman. One day, after I had gotten into my full getup, I started to teeter my way onto the set. Along the way, I passed the trucking crew, who promptly ripped me a new asshole. Hey, Gene, looking good. Hey, what are you doing later, baby? It's all right, yeah. Anyway, you slide, slide. You know you can't deny it. I hated it. During one of the scenes, I had to mouth an old Wayne County line. It takes a man like me to be a woman like me. My backup band were real transvestites who gave me tips on how to be convincing. The movie also starred John Stamos and Vanity, who enjoyed flirting with me as much as I enjoyed flirting back. Then in 1986, I was offered a film called Red Surf. The cast included Dee Dee Pfeiffer, Michelle's sister, and George Clooney. I played a Vietnam vet who has had his fill of killing. At the end of the movie, I had to come and save everyone from certain death. I was getting accustomed to the movie business. I was living in California with Shannon while the rest of the band was in New York. Eric was working out just great on drums, and the whole touring environment was stress-free for the first time. Now that Ace and Peter were no longer in the band.
Right, well, I'm pleased to be able to welcome to Studio One at Radio Air quite literally a phenomenon in modern rock music. Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley from KISS. Gentlemen, welcome to Radio Air.
Thank you. You make us blush.
Well, let's start with the latest album, which is, in fact, is your 18th album.
I think
in
album,
England, I think it's 19th.
Yeah, mm-hmm. We had a release that the record company put together called Killers, which was pretty much a compilation of old stuff and a few new tracks that were done between The Elder and Creatures of the Night. So this is the 19th.
In America, it's the 18th.
It's the 18th,
one.
Yeah.
I see. Well, Eric Carle's quoted as saying, "This is the best you've done, bar none." That's something of a sweeping statement after 19 albums. What makes it better than the others?
It's the second decade for us. We've been doing this for 10 years, and after a while, you sort of get a very clear, precise picture of who it is that you are, what it is you want to do, and regardless of styles, fashion, what's in, what's out, if it's blue hair, green hair, short hair, long hair, that's not the point. We really come to grips with who it is that we are, and I think this album captures exactly who we are right now. And we hope, obviously, to make the next album better than this one.
It passed the wet test.
A lot of the lyrics in rock band songs are inspired by experiences on tour. I mean, is this true of you?
I think you can't, if you're going to go on tour, and if you want to be a real rock and roll band and not a bunch of sissies who stay on the beaches of Tahiti or somewhere, you're going to start writing about what you live. And we live rock and roll. We live being in hotels. We live meeting people after the shows. We live parties. So, sure, I mean, Lick It Up is basically just the last tour. It's just a bunch of songs that were written while we were on tour in America.
Mm.
And, sure, I mean, that's what rock and roll is all about. Once you cut yourself off from your fans and you cut yourself off from the people, you're no longer relevant. I mean, you've got to be out in the street and you've got to have time to see your fans, and you have to know what they like, what they don't like.
Now, Gene, some of the fans who listen to my rock show have expressed a disappointment that you've decided to bare your faces to the public's gaze. I'm sure you must have explained this point about the makeup to many journalists so far.
Mm-hmm.
One guy wrote to me and said he thought the people he saw on the front cover of Lick It Up were imposters. What would you be your...
Oh, I'm not Gene Simmons. I was sent here. No, my name is Bob Foster. I was sent here by Gene Simmons.
Oh, that throws a whole new light on it.
So the question is, why now? Or why at all?
Yeah.
Well, ironically enough, 10 years ago, everybody was saying, well, why? 10 years ago, before we even started putting the makeup on, people were asking us why we were putting on makeup in the first place. And now, 10 years later, we're taking it off because we've decided to take it off, not because of any pressure or whatever. Certainly, you know, the opposite. And now people are asking us why. So I think we always have to keep one thing in mind, that whatever it is that we do, we have to believe in. You have to be sincere in whatever it is that you do. You can't do it because of fashion or because of other forces. And then if people see that you're honest about what it is that you do, they will accept it. I believe that, you know, that's always been our philosophy, that, you know, this is our 19th record in England, and most of the records we're very, very proud of. And I think if the music is what you're talking about, you're really not talking about the music, you're talking about a change in what it is that we look like on stage.
These days, it's more important to be, well, as important to be visual as to be right musically as well.
Yeah, we wrote the book on being visual.
Right.
And everybody who wants to be visual takes lessons from seeing us. So nothing changes. Makeup isn't what made us visual. Makeup doesn't make you sweat. Makeup doesn't make you do splits and tumbles, and makeup doesn't make you give 110% to the audience. What KISS always stands for, stood for, will stand for, till the day that we either die or decide to go on to something else, is total commitment to our audience and giving 110%. And that goes way beyond makeup. I think that you had a different hairstyle probably 10 years ago, and for somebody to say you should have the same hairstyle 10 years later is kind of, it's shallow. And I think that most of our fans realize that, and the other ones will see it anyway. I mean, people sometimes need a little period of adjustment, but I gotta say, it's really the vast minority, because everybody, KISS fans are KISS fans. KISS fans know that KISS is in our hearts, and that's what we believe in.
It must have been a distinct advantage to be able to walk around in public without being recognized.
Oh, it's great. I remember on a couple of occasions coming into towns, middle American towns, and going in to get a hamburger or whatever, the staple American diet, and walking through the crowd and talking with people about the concert tonight and, you know, who's going to be there. And you really get a sense of what it is that people think about you. I remember buying a ticket at the front door of Madison Square Garden in New York, walking in through the front, through the crowd, through the front gate, into the dressing room, and then coming up on stage and performing on stage. So there's that sort of, I think we're much closer to our audience than most bands. Most bands have that sort of separation. And we don't, now that you can tell who we look like and who we are, we don't intend to be
you know, these distant sort of people who live in Cannes and these other exotic places.
Right. It's nice to see, actually, when you came into the station that you you don't mind signing Nth autographs and talking to people and being street level.
The fans made us.
Right.
We are, without the fans, we are nothing. And maybe most bands or a lot of bands forget that, but the fans are everything.
Mm-hmm.
And we have as much time as they need. I mean, when we did a record signing last year in London, we must have signed a good 2,000 autographs.
Mm.
But if you only sign 1,999, then there's one person
who's going to write to the music papers.
We don't care about who needs music papers. He's going to be unhappy. And everybody deserves, if they're behind us, we got to be behind them.
Mm.
And music papers, we can take or leave. If they love us, then we appreciate it. Mm. But the only thing we're concerned with is our fans. And if we let one of them down, that's one too many. We try to do our best not to.
It's nice to hear you say that. I was surprised to read somewhere, just changing the subject, Vinnie Vincent said somewhere that Kiss's roots musically are Jeff Beck and Led Zeppelin. Why those two acts?
I don't know that you can really sort of put your finger on it. Everybody's got different influences. Vinnie was very influenced by early Beck, and certainly there's some Zeppelin influences. I loved those two bands, but they weren't the total of it. I love Slade. I still do, conceptually, always have.
Mm.
Four guys who get up on stage and sweat, and that's no secret to them. They certainly know that.
Mm.
They're basically, I think, Kiss roots or English roots based on American music. What English bands did during the late 60s, 69, 70, around then, you know, The Who did some wonderful things. And I think the only difference between us and a lot of bands is that it's a four-wheel drive band. There's no sort of one person who's just carrying the show. There are four people who are sweating their butts off to make sure that you have a good time, that you forget about your homework and that your girlfriend left you, or that there's going to be a traffic jam on the way out. For those 3 hours, you're going to forget about everything and have a good time.
We don't want, you know, some people who are not into what we do come to a show and say, well, you're too loud. But you don't go to a show to talk to the person next to you. If you can talk to the person next to you, we're not loud enough.
Hmm.
You know, you're not there for a conversation or debate. You're there to be one with us. We want you to be one of us. Hmm. And the only way to do that is to envelop everything. You know, we will give you as much as you give us, and the more we get from the audience, the more we can give.
And it's not just a concert from beginning to end. We really have spaces in there where we want to hear the audience, and we'll stop songs halfway through to hear what the audience sounds like. And they know that, and they know that when the stops happen, we want to hear them. It's the back and forth. It's not just giving something to somebody. There's a give and take. We give them something, they give us something.
What we found is, for us, let's say in Leeds, you have people who are waiting to see us. We're waiting to see the people in Leeds.
Right. You're interested in Leeds rock fans.
You betcha. Sure. You betcha. And us doing a show, we are seeing our fans. And that is as important as them seeing us.
Hmm.
And each city is different, got different fans, and we got to meet them all.
Can I turn the subject to Ace Frehley? What's happened to him?
I saw Ace about 2 weeks ago. We worked on something together. Ace is fine. He's got a wife, a baby, and a house in the country. And that's the lifestyle that he's decided to lead. And
the country squire.
The country squire. And Ace is fine. He is willing or may not be able to lead this sort of lifestyle, but when you're in Kiss, you marry three other people. You get married to the band and to the fans. Not your girlfriend, not your wife, not your dog, not your babies. None of that stuff can have an effect, and you can't have a girl tugging at your sleeve saying, when are you coming home from tour and why don't you do one less interview and you know, sort of
total dedication.
Yeah, you want to be in Kiss, it's 24 hours. If you want a 50-50 sort of lifestyle,
then you join IS.
Yeah, then you do something else. This is not a part-time thing.
Why did you take the unusual step of producing four solo albums in, I think it was September 78?
We were lucky. I mean, most bands, you know one member. You don't know the four members or five members or whatever. And what we were lucky enough at that point, we had, I think, five or six albums at that point in a real short span of time. And to give us each a chance to really let off some steam individually, we were in a position where Neil Bogart was saying, look, you guys can all do your own album. And it's great to work in a group situation, but it's also like everybody's dream to go off and do everything on their own. So with that in mind, we went off and did it. Most bands, when somebody goes off and does a solo album, it means the band's over. And us, it just meant, you know, we were letting off a little steam, stretching out a bit.
Initially, it did give that impression that you were splitting up, although you quickly...
But that, every single year that we've been around, people... At the end of our first year, the press starts, right, well, that's it. Second year, well, that's it. And on and on. And every single year, oh, of course they're breaking up, because how can they put up with the pace, or aren't they tired of this, or, you know, why tour when you don't have to? They're really missing the point. We're not Kiss because we have to be, but because we love it. You know, this is something that we enjoy doing. I'm not in Leeds tonight because I have to be here, but because I want to be here.
Right, you're not in it for the money, you're in it because you want to do it.
We started as a rock and roll band. We started playing guitars and turning up amps because that's what we love doing.
Mm-hmm.
We're turning up amps and playing guitars today because we love doing it. You don't do anything well unless you love it. I mean, you can't fool anybody. Commitment.
Yeah, you can't fool.
Commitment is everything.
No, but it obviously comes over. Did the cartoon film Kiss Meets the Phantom come up to your expectations?
As far as we know, it was not a cartoon film. It was a live action one. That's all right.
First of all, I must admit, I've never seen it. I'd heard it was.
Did it come
obviously
up
I'm
to
wrong.
Our expectations?
No,
not at all. There were a lot of problems with it, and sometimes when you're in the midst of doing something, your best bet is to keep going forward and get it done and do the best you can. I think there were funny parts and it was kind of interesting, but it was something that seemed to go kind of, it took on a character and a life of its own and just went wherever it wanted to.
Originally it was going to be an action film with lots of special effects and it turned into something else. It's okay. I don't think we're sorry for ever having done it. It just didn't come out anywhere near what we expected. But that's okay. You live and you learn.
I think also what happened was TV censorship entered into it. And a lot of the stuff that we wanted to have in it that was much truer to what we are was never going to be allowed past the censors. Even in as much as there were some fight sequences in it where they wound up playing cartoon music underneath it because they didn't want it to have any kind of overtones of any kind of destruction or
because American TV censors are much harsher than they are in this country.
I was saying to Gene before, TV over here and commercials and everything on television are just the best. Comedians over here are great. You know, I mean, there's words flung around on TV here.
Oh,
that
you get away with murder.
That
you
get
here.
Thrown off TV in 5 minutes if you did it in America.
Have you ever heard of Not the 9 o'clock News?
Yes.
Right, well, they get away with possibly, they push it to the limit, as it were.
What was the last time I saw it? Was it Stomping on the Duck? Is that what it is? Stomping on the Cat? Stomping on the Elephant?
Right,
like
yeah.
Yeah, you know, I mean, when you hear comedians talking about, you know, well, you know, I don't even know what we can say on this thing. But
a female, talking about how she was dissatisfied with her sex life and how every night it was like missing the express train to Manchester or something. And she always wishes she was on that train with him or something. But I mean, the imagery was very clear, and
I saw the phallic symbols of the train, etc.
One comedian was talking about, well, you know, I went out and if you do this, maybe you'll be able to get laid. Now, if you said get laid, we may be off the air now,
no,
right?
No, fine.
But that's amazing, because in America, we would say that right now, and they would stop tape and say, look, you know, we'll do that again, and why don't you come up with another word for that? So it's real interesting. I mean, I'm watching television last night, and the commercials here are just the best. Dynamite commercials.
Can I turn back to your music for a moment?
Let's talk about
American TV commercials. Like, Music from the Elder, it wasn't really a great success in Kiss terms in this country. Can you explain why?
Kiss has always been about being totally committed to what you're doing, and sometimes we take left-hand turns. That's who it is that we are. As early as 1976, we decided to do a ballad, and that had nothing to do with Kiss, but we wanted to do it. And The Elder was an experiment that we wanted to try, and we did it, and we're proud that we did it, and then you move on. And because of The Elder, it clears up the perspective a little bit, maybe, and then you get a very clear point of reference that, you know, the next album is not what you... You don't want to do The Elder Part 2.
Mm.
And Creatures was born because of that.
It's also interesting that people... Some people will hear something like The Elder or Beth and say, well, they're not heavy metal anymore. Mm. And you need that freedom, you know.
To do something else.
Absolutely. I mean, you're sitting here with a blue shirt on. Now, I would never in a million years say, well, he wears blue shirts every day. You know, your identity has to have that much flexibility. So, I mean, we are absolutely what we are, always have been, but... In being that, it means we need the freedom to experiment.
Mm. You obviously experiment with your live shows as well. What can people going to a Kiss concert today expect musically and visually?
Dedication is a big word. I mean, we can use words to describe what the stage looks like, the fact that the drum riser is on top of a tank that moves and does all sorts of things, but we won't.
Right. Don't spoil
that
for
me. We've always... Kiss is more about the people than about the things that are on the stage or what they do. It's about four people who are willing to do everything short of kill themselves to make sure that the audience has a good time. So,
and the band has a great time, which is...
We love it.
We certainly don't look pained. Yeah. You know, when we're talking about killing ourselves, it's really like the ultimate joy what we're doing.
You must consider yourselves to be very lucky people, really.
We
are. The
positions
you're in.
Yeah. We really are.
It's really about dedication, and it's not about effects. If Kiss is about effects, then it's the effect the audience is having on Kiss and the effect that Kiss is having on the audience.
Right.
More that than the bombs.
Mm. And as far as the future is concerned for you now, do you just intend to continue making albums, touring, and going on ad infinitum?
Sure.
As long as it's good for... You know, there's that conversation that goes on after each love affair. Was it good for you? Yes, it was good for me. And it always takes two. And it's a continuing love affair between us and the audience. As long as it's good for both of us, it'll continue. When one of us... When it's no longer fun for one of us,
then we'll smoke a cigarette.
Then we'll smoke a cigarette and then say,
"I owe you one."
Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons, thanks very much for coming in.
It's great being here.
Thank you, and thank the fans.